Hello, and welcome to Judging by the Cover, where we'll be judging the new Doom by popular demand and the cover. When designing a cover, one of the most important things to keep in mind is what colour scheme would be most fitting for the subject matter. In this case, Doom is a notoriously bloody and gory game about killing fiery hell demons on Mars. So what primary colours spring to mind when you consider all those themes? Blood, gore, fire, hell demons, and Mars. That's right, yellowy brown. Nothing evokes bloody hell murder quite like a bloke immersed in a glass tank full of his own stale piss. I suppose it could have gotten discoloured from all the people who've been whittling over it since it was revealed, complaining that it's a little bit generic. And it is, in the sense that David Berkowitz was a little bit tightly wound. This is like a clip show of all the generic modern cover bullshit we've seen on the show so far. You've got your neutral pose in front of a blank background, well, save for a Photoshop cloud filter like someone emptied their glass of milk into the big vat full of piss. And you've got the ever-popular attempt to emphasise action where no action exists, with the random particles and sparks flying around the completely motionless figure. I think this deserves a name. From now on, I'm going to call it Bombfetti. It's long been out of fashion to do the thing they did with the Doom 1 box art and make the game logo look like a huge, chunky physical thing that someone built in their garage. No, these days it's uncool to look like you give a shit about things. Might as well just stencil the logo in plain white paint that didn't even stick properly. So now our Space Marine hero looks like he's standing outside a glass door trying to figure out if it's automatic. Rather unfortunately positioned so that the two O's in Doom look like he's got a great big pair of saggy breasts. I say he could easily be a woman under all that, wouldn't be the first time video games pulled that particular fast one. Just look at those slim, dainty little fingers clutching the shotgun like a cheerleader's first awkward hand job attempt. Perfectly suited to hang on to that minuscule grip on the end for gingerly holding the gun steady with your fingertips when you don't want to mess up your nail varnish. Wait, isn't that a Yale lock on the side? Gun safety technology must have regressed somewhat in the future. Imagine the embarrassment if you arrived at the gun battle and realised you'd left your keys on the mantelpiece. The case against the main character being a woman is that the weird extrusion on the top of the helmet makes it look a bit like he's wearing a squashed-down fedora. If you look closely, you can see an eye and a nose through the visor, gender inconclusive, but they are wearing a monocle over the left eye, so we've narrowed down their identity to either a woman or Great-Uncle Pennybags. See how their one visible eye seethes with rage at the audacity of the bird who shat on their visor while they were sleeping. Either that or he's mad at the little red lights blinking away right next to both his eyes for no apparent reason. Maybe they're for keeping track of how many beers he's got left out of his six-pack. So what's with the asymmetrical shoulder armour? Did something get snapped off the right shoulder? Or is there a reason why only the left shoulder pad has to have a beak? Is it statistically more likely that head height attacks are going to be coming from the left? Didn't seem to do much to stop the fucking bird shit on the visor, did it? If you're gonna put extra armour somewhere, what about these great big fucking gaps here? I can see right through the armour to the corduroy jumper he's got on underneath. Maybe it's not armour. Maybe it's a battle trophy. Maybe he fought against an army of Jim Henson puppets and that's a helmet he took from a dead fraggle. But our assumptions are all turned on their head when we examine the battle damage on the Fraggle helmet and see that underneath the outer layer of metallic paint, the armour looks suspiciously like scarred flesh. And that leads us to the horrifying yet inescapable conclusion, oh god, he's not wearing armour. He's wearing a skin-tight leotard and that's just what his body's shaped like. His mum must have been impregnated by a fucking jump jet. I think that's all we're going to get out of this image, which might not even end up being the final box art since everyone thinks it's so generic. But then again, it's virtually identical to the Doom 3 box art. Single character in mid-shot, looming over the logo with the suggestion that their neck muscles are thick enough to stop an industrial snowplow. Well, one of them's a suggestion, and the other's a 2,000-page government-funded report on the subject. Doom 3, however, was smart enough to avoid several of the pitfalls the new Doom blundered into. The logo has been shifted enough to the side that one couldn't interpret the O's as great big sagging titties, nor are they low down enough to conceivably be testicles instead. The pose is actually somewhat active without the need for bomfetti, and the background isn't totally featureless. There's a weird circle pattern going on that looks like the monster is getting taken up the arse by Strong Sad. But most importantly, there's actual personality on display. Instead of just standing there aloof like a smoulderingly badass cardboard cutout, the Doom 3 monster is raving like he's backstage at the WWE. Space Marine thinks he's so tough because he murdered a few fraggles. Let's see how tough you are against something that doesn't have a hand up its arse. Big fucking talk for someone who doesn't even have neck muscles so huge they grew their own vagina.